very important to me. I did this in my youth, and it kind of represents the change and the struggle. It's called recession, all right? Activism and capitalism, ever seen a more merry team working three jobs, no sleep, never seen American dream. It's a blue-collar nightmare, please don't pull your hair and scream, because the naked truth is way too bare to demean. Hold up! Let me not over and understate, because the so-called free market economy is sort of great. But it's odd how corporations choose to incorporate methods to trap people's progression, preventing the poor escape. Nah, nope. Gave me a cold shoulder and asked for an overcoat. What we learned from the big three middle class, please hold up your notes. But if you can't hold those for plain votes, in fact, let me quote a very old joke. People stand for a job, but job stands for just over broke. What a joke.
Yes, yes, yes.
The pro show. So do you own up or be foreclosed? Why would I refinance a torn home? Chose not to live a lie. Yeah, I don't mourn those. Economy and competition, were they born foes? For every high 1%, 99 seem to form lows. Oh no, everyone seeks power, refusing to speak, relinquish amendments, and just cower. Confused, we allude to what's theirs and what's ours, climbing up the poverty line in 9 to 5 hours. That's why most businesses are at the top of the towers, and before the sweet life, motels seem sour. But big businesses are just hooks for fish to devour. A country ran by baby boomers blooming flowers. Petals of peace and love with a stem of hate. And yes, I understand the national problem stems from states. But if you deregulate, won't the banks raise interest rates? Come on, Uncle Sam. System checks trying to stimulate. Now, I talked about the problem, but here's the problem fixing. Can all these CEOs stop trying to become politicians? They have no morale. They just know how to be efficient. Money's not what my wallet's missing, because check cashings are never in good neighborhoods. Instead of spending, they invest in major goods. Young entrepreneur increased hopes his wages would. If making a buck was easy as the business page said it could be. Obviously, from the stock market's orderly source, someone's making a dollar off the quarterly reports. Layoffs cut production. How much more of these can they force? Work unions step in and try to handle this, because these companies are acting Enron scandalous. Yes. Someone manage it or bandage it, because these bailouts are letting a DEP be added to the RE in recession.
Woo. All right. Woo. Yes.
Woo. How y'all doing?
I'm going to hand it over to Meg.
Speak of May Day and when we speak of the Industrial Revolution. workers' rights at that time in Chicago in like late 1800s. Lucy was from Texas, and I don't think it's true, but a lot of people say that she may have denied her African ancestry, but I doubt that that's the case, but you may hear that. But Lucy was a very light-skinned woman who could be considered Native American or Spanish, but she had African ancestry, and she was from Texas. She was married to a man who was a European, and his name was Albert. And Albert was very known for working and registering people to vote, black people to vote during that time. Because of Albert's work and Lucy's, they were a threat to that society where they resided. And Albert was shot in the leg, and he was also threatened with lynching, just like anybody else who may stand up because they have that genuine love for humanity and people with capitalist interests may want to quiet. So at that time, Albert was shot, and they moved to Chicago. And it wasn't out of fear, but it was just necessary for the work that they done. They were not a people that were afraid, to be clear on that. But they moved to Chicago, and they became really, really active in Chicago with the workers' revolution. There was a strike on the railroad, maybe 1871. If anybody is more certain of the year than I am, let me know, but I'm gonna say early 1870. There was a strike at the railroad because there was some wage cuts. Now keep in mind that people weren't already making enough money to begin with. We just come from a situation with the Industrial Revolution where the mode of production had changed. You know, they started to build more industries and a lot of people were just working. We come from like slavery to capitalism. You know, the mode of production changed. So people are still slaves, but they are getting paid. They're getting paid now. So there was a cut. And the people said, no, we're not going to do that. So in Chicago, they organized themselves in great, great numbers. And they went to the railroads and they actually overturned rail cars. And it was a threat to capitalism. Because capitalism was a new face. And the people said, no, this is not what we're going to have. So Chicago sparked something great. A lot of people died from that reality. A lot of people died. And so, sorry. I'm like, I heard my phone ringing, but it must be okay. But a lot of people lost their lives. And in my opinion, it wasn't in vain because wherever you find resistance to anything that is wrong, I think it's a great thing and sacrifice is necessary sometimes. Most times. So anyway, because of it, a lot of people died. The government sent in cannons. They sent in swords and guns, and a lot of people lost their lives. So the people then went and they processed that situation at the Haymarket riot. And so, yeah, it's good. And the great part about this is being here is that you won't be the only person to know. More people will know. So this is why we're here, because we want to remember these things. We want to remember those people that sacrificed before us. And we want to learn from it so we can return to the same. But anyway, so from May, Haymarket, do you know the exact year?
May 4th, 1886.
Okay. Not 1986, but 1886. Okay. Yeah. So they protested. They protested in great numbers. And then police officers came, and there was some bombs or something thrown where it got the crowd all shook up, and a couple of officers lost their lives. So what they tried to do, the state tried to charge some key people in inciting it and being responsible for the throwing of the bombs and so forth. But you know, they instigate things like that to create those situations. So there were six people who had to go on trial for it. And one of the people was Albert. I'm not sure of Lucy's husband, Albert's last name at this moment, but he was one of the people who had to go before to be tried for this situation at the Haymarket. And so Albert at first, he was like, man, fuck that, I ain't going, you know what I'm saying? They can't get me, I ain't comrades, those that he worked with, you know what I'm saying, people that he struggled with. And he said, you know, they're captured. I'm not going to go and hide and let them deal with it themselves, even though I don't want to, but I'm going to go ahead and be tried. So he went finally, he turned himself in, and he went, and they all were innocent. Now, I wasn't there, but I do try to be accurate with how I understand things. And I believe that he was an innocent man, along with his comrades. And so they were tried, and he was in prison. And eventually, Albert, he was hung for this. Now, not only did they hang Albert and his comrades as a form of punishment, but they wanted to teach the world a lesson, as always, from that situation. So Lucy, she was always the advocate for her husband. She was always the advocate for human rights. She was always the advocate for everything that was, you know, morally conscious. If she seen something incorrect, she would move on it where she had the capacity to. So in this particular case, she stood up for her husband in the whole trial. She went everywhere and talked about it and protested it and did everything that she possibly could do. So they knew Lucy. She became a power. Lucy was known to be more powerful and more dangerous to this system than 1,000 rioters. This is what they said to this woman. So when they killed her husband, they wanted to make a statement. So they took Lucy and her kids, and they actually put them in a cell while her husband was being hung, stripped them naked and degraded them and all kinds of stuff, for them to just be there and not necessarily watch because they was in a different place, but just to demean them, just to make the situation worse so she could shut the hell up. But she did not. After her husband was killed by lynching, she continued to work even greater. Lucy was a revolutionary in every sense of the word. Lucy could not be confined to being an anarchist or a communist or a socialist. Or you couldn't fit her under one umbrella because Lucy was a hard worker, and through her work she developed herself. She developed and she kept going, and the more she worked, the more she learned. And Lucy, she contributed so much to humanity, to resistance, to capitalism, to exposing them to who they are, to the world. She had tons and tons of literature. She died at the age of 89. And I would mention like all the papers she wrote for, but it's so many. But her work, when she died at the age of 89, her work in her library, in her house, it was like so immense. But as soon as she died and they got word, the FBI came in and raided her house and took all of her literature because they don't want y'all to know. But see, that's why we're here today, because we carry the work. We speak for those who work for us. This is our responsibility to one another. So we won't be silent. It's 2014 and Lucy still lives. But the FBI sees everything she ever created inside of the house because they don't want y'all to know about it. But that's just how powerful and dynamic she was. She was a great woman, and I'm glad to be here on this day to be able to speak of her name. And that's the least that I can do, because she did create, she didn't create, but she worked towards the process of creating an 8-hour workday that many of you benefit from. I mean, 9 to 5, I mean, I'm not saying that it's a great thing. It's not absolutely great. It could be better, because y'all really not enjoying the true fruits of your labor. But just imagine, you could still be a slave. You could. Just imagine if nobody ever had anything to say about slavery. Nobody. Nobody said anything. They said anything at all. People would still be slaves. Just imagine. 8 hours used to be 15-hour workdays. Some places still is. Some places not. That's what I'm saying. Things that you see change. As human beings, we evolve. But we want to evolve in a revolutionary way. And whatever is incorrect, it's our responsibility to make it correct, not for our individual selves, but for the collective. So I pay homage to Lucy. She is my idol, or whatever word you want to call it, heroine. And she's never to be forgotten. And it's your responsibility to speak of her name or anybody that you know that has that same, you know, gusto. So thank you, Lucy. And we have some more hot dogs. They're probably cold.
you and tell you when we're having events. You want to know. You should want to sign your name. Next up, we have a speaker from System Change, not Climate Change, because it's not the climate that's broken, it's the system. And so next up, Gary Stewart.
Are you glad to be here?
Yeah.
I can't hear you! I'm Gary. I'm with System Change, like Climate Change. I'm on the North American Steering Committee for System Change. I'm also chair of the Environmental Working Committee for Dallas Move On, and I'm also with Solidarity. So I'm trying to cover those three. With System Change, like Climate Change, we are an eco-socialist organization for North America. And basically, we're going to speak the unspeakable. Capitalism has got to go. Because it is killing us. It's killing us, killing our communities. It's killing us with go-nowhere jobs. It's killing us with jobs that don't pay us enough. It kills us by providing us jobs that don't provide us insurance. Or even if we can pay for the insurance, we can't even afford to go to the hospital even if we have insurance. But what's really, and that's insidious, but the truth is, we are in the middle of an ecological catastrophe that is unfolding faster and faster and faster. The IPCC, the Interplanetary Climate Change Committee, has been coming out with their reports yearly. And this year, they're acknowledging that it's worse than what they feared. And that is happening far quickly, far more rapidly than they had thought. And so to kind of put it as simply as possible, they're saying that if we're going to avoid catastrophic overheating of the planet, I mean, we're going to have global warming. We already have global warming. So we can't prevent it. We're already in it, and it's going to get worse. Okay? But if we want to prevent the absolute worst, which would be beyond 4 degrees increase on the temperature on the globe, and even go higher than that, we have to reduce carbon greenhouse gas emissions by 2020 by 40%. We're nowhere near that now. But if we to avoid the most catastrophic form of global warming, by 2050, we would have to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 95%. Let me repeat that. Did you hear that? Did you hear that? 95% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2050. Are we anywhere near that?
No.
No. And do you think your politicians, Dimmies, Democrats, and Republicans, do you think they're even caring about it? Do you think they're even trying to do anything about it? None of them. None of them are. Look at Obama and his catastrophic performance in Copenhagen several years ago. We were missing in action. We had people who deny climate change, the reality of it. And one of the worst people of it lives here in Dallas, ExxonMobil. Have you heard of them? For years they have spent money to disinform people, to lie to people, to tell them climate change is not real. Climate change is not real. Just recently there was a movie called Lying Dirty Bastards about greedy corporate heads. And they had a film, somebody went inside to the shareholders meeting of ExxonMobil. And the maker of the documentary asked the question saying, what about global warming? And he admitted, the CEO of ExxonMobil admitted, yes, climate change is real. And then that was it. Now they're saying, oh, well, we can adjust. There is no adjustment to the kind of catastrophic increases in temperature that we're going to be facing. We already have droughts. We already have extreme weather. We already have islands that are disappearing and their people are having to leave. We've seen Texas is in a permanent drought. California's drought is getting worse and worse and worse. How long does it take for us to wake up? So the question is no longer, will our politicians wake up? They are dead. Yep. Did you hear that? Your politicians are dead. They're
brain
soulless.
Dead.
They don't give a damn.
They're brain dead.
They don't
dead.
Give a damn about you or your children or your family. They'll expose your family to carcinogenic gases from fracking, from tar sands. They don't care. They're bought. They're sold. They're dead. So what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? What are we going to do about it? The thing is, we have to, one, give up the bankrupt two-party system. It's a lie. It's a sham. It's a fraud. It's a crime. We need to toss them out. There may be a few good Dimmies. And go ahead, we can vote for them. But that's, we put no faith in the Democratic Party. And as for the GOP, that goes beyond.
Yes.
Both of them are poison, okay? The Demis, the Democrats are a little bit slower and have a nice smiley face on the poison. The GOP is far quicker and it's nastier, okay? But they're both poison. So the thing is, we need to organize as independents until we can create our own independent party, if we ever need to do that. There is an organization called the League of Independent Voters. Woo! And it's trying to bring in disaffected Democrats, liberals, socialists, anarchists, greens, to come together and say, where can we find commonality? And so we can run candidates who are beholden to us, not to some monstrous political machine. But then we also need to organize. We need to speak the unspoken truth that capitalism is a death wish. We need to come up with policies that challenge the control. And what I mean by capitalism, let me try to make it simple. The fact is we have private interests, private capital that is controlling policy decisions within the city, within the state, within our nation, and globally. Again, it's capital owned by the rich, by the corporations, by Wall Street, that are making decisions that affect our lives, your lives, and they don't care. All they care about is what?
Money.
Money, profit, short-term profit. The planet can go to hell. And it is. But they don't care, they don't see. Jesus said of them, they have eyes, but they cannot see. They have ears, they cannot hear. So what system change, not climate change, other organizations are trying to do is say, you are the government. 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 You are the power. Quit. We need to quit looking to politicians to save us. They're incapable of it. It's up to us to organize, to find issues that we can work on together, from fracking, from going to Austin and swarming the state capitol. When it comes to the legislative session, which is, God help us, and I'm an atheist, God help us when the state legislature meets. But we need to go there and raise hell and tell them, no, 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 no. Stop gutting our social services. Stop privatizing our social services. Stop privatizing our education. Stop privatizing our energy. Stop privatizing healthcare. Stop privatizing everything for somebody else's goddamn profit. That's what it takes. So.
Stop privatizing the IST.
Well, yeah. Everything. So, thank you for being here. And I hope you sign up for whatever organizations or all of them. Because we're all going to have to work together. And you know, there's a lot. There's a lot coming towards us. There's a lot we have to deal with. But I want to close by saying I'm the most optimistic I've ever been in my life. I mean, I lived through the dark, dark, evil, or I should say very white, white years of Reagan. And I thought that was the end of the world. I thought that was the end of the world.
Amen, brother.
Yeah, that was really bad. But despair is a luxury we cannot afford. Despair is a luxury we cannot afford. Only cowards will go that way. But together, when we work together, talk together, plan together, And there's enough things to work on, folks, locally and statewide and nationally and internationally. But let's come together as a community and realize we're in the same ship. And if we don't do something, we're all going down. We're going down. Even with those evil banksters, we're all going to go down unless we get off our asses, organize, listen to each other, support each other, love each other by working together for justice. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. Gary, so I have a favorite climate chant, and I'm going to take this opportunity to teach it to you really quickly. And it goes, the planet, the planet, the planet's on fire. We don't need no fracking, let the corporations burn. And you can put anything in there. You could put pipeline, you could put oil. I mean, it's a really versatile chant for all occasions. But next up, we're going to switch it back up with some little art. I'm an artist. If my movement doesn't have art in it, it's not a movement I want to be in. So next up, we have Solace, and I was asked to introduce him, reviving the elements of hip-hop, Solace, so give it up. Woo!
How y'all doing? Hey,
man.
My name's Solace 28, and originally we were supposed to perform up there, but I'm going to go ahead and share a couple pieces with you guys. Can you hear me clear?
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Is it okay to record?
Yeah, that's cool. I'll wait for you. But like she was saying, I'm part of a group called Reviving the Elements of Hip Hop, and we are a group of positive, motivational hip hop artists. We go into the schools, we go into the rec centers, all around the DFW, all around the United States, and we go out there and we try to change the lives of our youth. And we know that if we start with the youth, that's going to make a change for the future. And so we have a couple events coming up. This Saturday, we will be at the Pan-African Connection. We're having the Goddess Fest. We got a couple outreaches coming out soon. You can check us out on rehp.org. You got it ready? All right, cool. Y'all ready? Here we go. I'm out of the box, spitting truth like an arrow to a target. Society tried to keep me within the margins. I crossed those lines and found out lies, which answered the reason why they couldn't tell me why. Why I have no peace within inside me. Gave religion to cover up and then hide me. And at the same time, blind me. To God send a brother to open the blinds, open my eyes, reveal truth. And now I see why my people still stuck in poverty. High gas prices in the hood, but they swearing up and down that they're helping me. I want you in the same place as what you're telling me. We have power, because they know if we were given a fair chance, we would hold up our hands, yelling at them, saying we got power. Can't nobody tell us nothing unless we have facts. That's still identity, but I'm taking mine back. And that's somebody where the truth be at, because it ain't where the news be at. If I had control and knew exactly how to get it, do you really think that I would be open just to give it? Forget it. That lets me know that everything that's out in the open is only meant to keep us hoping without knowing. And that right there is called New Identity. That's my first piece. These next couple songs, I'm gonna do a verse from a deal called Hip Hop Part 2, and then you'll hear Hip Hop Part 1 after that. Here we go. Hitherwise, coming through your speakers, bumping in your ride. Got some deeper issues that you know I had to coincide. Hoping you relate, then listen and coincide. Other rappers giving youth the lyrical homicide. Tell them get that money any way she can. Even if she gotta sleep with dozens of men. Cause cash rules everything around her. Creaming. Why I so hurting is she screaming. Multiple abortions, babies never seen. Affecting her emotions, so she always calls a scene. She misunderstood and misdirected. My innocent baby, sorry that you got affected with that misconception. Do whatever. So you on top. Gotta lose her soul for that number one spot to nowhere. A status only good in the hood. Real women make real money, get understood. And that's Hip Hop Part 2. And this next one, can I get y'all participation on it?
Yeah.
It's called Hip Hop. So when I say everybody say hip, hop, hip, hop. I want y'all to say it exactly like that. Say it with me. Everybody say hip,
hop, hip, hop, hip, hop.
Let me hear it. Everybody say it.
Hip, hop, hip.
There we go, here we go, first word. I'm talking about getting my little brother up out of jail, getting these baby mothers somewhere found, getting my little boys up these streets, protecting that girl when nobody there. She's scared, tired of being alone, wondering why mama never answering the phone. Why a stepdad is far too grown for her to be touched like a mother do. And this happens right after school. It ain't right, it ain't cool. for him to be doing to her what he do, what he does, it's like a fool. They used to touch him when he was younger. And this is a cycle that started with his mother, a generational curse that needs to be over. Yeah, but we still got hip, hop, hip, hop, hip, hop. To change hip, this world, we got
hip, hop, hip, hop.
Yeah,
hip, hop.
We can make a change through
hip, hop, hip, hop, hip, hop.
Yeah, hip, hop. I'm talking about getting my little brothers up out of jail, getting these baby mothers off welfare, getting my little boys off these streets, because he can't make it with no daddy there. He's 13 years of age, and in the streets, he feels safe. So in the streets, he go play, not realizing this is not a game. Hey, well, maybe he do, because he in the game, and they show him love every time he bang. Somebody head in every day, and he feeling like it's right because it's what he see. And what he see, he'll be. So death he sees, and then he'll be. Hey, but that's a shame. Why? Because we still got hip-hop. Thank y'all. My name is Silas 28. Like I said, you can check us out at rahp.org and our upcoming events. Thank you.
Thank you. Woo! Hey, that's me.
That's you.
It is me. All right, next up, we have a friend of mine, Rashad, who I met at school. He does some organizing on the side. And he's going to talk about some things.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Are you guys okay with me talking about some things?
Yes.
Well, I'll tell you what. It's nice to be here. I enjoy you guys coming out and having kicking it in the park. This is a community. This is unity right here. I talk a little bit about being a grassrooter. So anybody that has anything to say or wants to pass on information or thinks there's a problem, presenting a problem only frustrates people.
Good? Does it work?
I know.
Hello? Oh, you recording?
Yeah.
Okay.
So anybody who presents a problem only frustrates people. So we look for a solution. And on a collective basis, I've talked to several people in several different domains. Myself, I'm from New Orleans. I've been to different domains. I love Dallas. You guys are awesome. But I think we lack culture here. I think the whole point of us all coming together on one accord in unison is to build a culture, is to build a collective thought. Things like values and ethics and morals are, they seem absent in a sense to me here, wherever you go. I think we should always restate the rule so that we know what we're dealing with. Anybody in affirmation of these things?
Yes.
I mean, an ethic is something that is an agreed upon thought or agreed upon moral. So let's work toward a solution. Generally, I spit. Just like my hip hop brother right here, I spit. I've been doing it since young. My opinion is my opinion, and if you like to entertain or if you like to talk to me about something, please don't feel like you don't have the ability to talk to me. I'm gonna spit something for y'all, and I'd like some feedback, as any artist would. So
spit poet,
I represent ECC, El Centro College, Spoken Word Club. Check it out. I speak for more than one when I say I'm the son of a man who had a plan to be bigger than he was, bolder than the fuzz. Some of these mans took an oath to sling dope. Others was cutthroat long before they had a committee. I'm speaking fitties. Back of Rugers was called Smitty's. If you knew my city, then you had to be gritty or grimy. If you knew your way around the hood, you affiliated with slimy individuals. Junkies with residual service made you nervous, but there was regulars and you kept them on edge just to beat out your competitors. It wasn't perpetual hate like today. Cats was more about getting cake than what was on another man's plate. Back in the old days, people with old age was respected, even though they injected. Shooting for the sky wasn't the limit. The limit was the image of being content for which you had spit. If they knew then what we know now, they show how wax could be used for profit. They expose how blacks weren't the only ones to light up a rocket. Unity in the community. Do me a favor and send me a savior, because hustle wasn't the only thing my papa was made of. I'm a young man who grew up on the streets. I've learned a lot. I've learned my mom got killed at 17 as a byproduct of drugs and alcohol. and a lifestyle that's corrupted, maladaptive in a sense, if you will. As a product of my environment, I learn from everybody I come into contact with. And I'm out here today to say that I love you. I represent a human being, and we are built for community. Therefore, let us work on one accord. Thank y'all for y'all time and y'all energy. Y'all take it easy.
Build our own society and sing, sing, we will sing our own song. Asante Sana.
Yeah. Hell yes. I didn't know she was going to sing. I did not know it was going to happen. That was delightful. Thank you so much. All right, next up. We got the wonderful, the talented, my friend, who I've met once, but we were very close on Facebook. This is Eamon.
Woo! Ladies and gentlemen, capitalism is destroying this planet. Woo! It is a totalizing system of oppression. And I'm here today because I want to live in a world where people of every race, creed, gender, or religion, or nationality can have equal access to power. Woo! Not just a few assholes, like, that own everything that we are around. And you have to want to fight because it seems like they always have bigger buildings and more cops. But it's always taken dedicated people like you and me who've gotten together and struggled together that have changed the world and made it a better place. So I just want to sing a few songs for you guys. I hear the crying of the hungry in the deserts where they're wandering. Hear them crying out for heaven's own benevolence upon them. Hear destructive power prevailing. I hear fools falsely hailing to the crooked wits of tyrants when they call. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. I hear the sound of tearing pages and the roar of burning paper. All the crimes and acquisitions, sanctuary and ash and vapor. And the rattle of the shackle far beyond emancipating. And the lowliest you gather in their stall. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. Whistle Dixie with your money and your power. I can hear the flowers are growing in the rubble of the tower. I hear leaders quit their lying. I hear babies quit their crying. I hear soldiers quit their dying, one and all. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. And I hear the tender words from Zion. I hear Noah's waterfall. Hear the gentle Lamb of Judah sleeping at the feet of Buddha. And the prophets from Elijah to the old Paiute Ravaka take their places at the table when they're called. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. Woo! Yeah. Right, this is a sing-along. You guys like Pete Singer?
Yeah!
R.I.P. Pete Singer, yeah, totally. If you know it, sing along.
Sorry, I'm in the light.
If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning. I'd hammer in the evening, all over this land. I'd hammer out danger, I'd hammer out a warning, I'd hammer out the love between my brothers and my sisters all over this land. Well, if I had a bell, I'd ring it in the morning, I'd ring it in the evening, all over this land. I'd ring out a warning, I'd ring out danger, I'd ring out the love between my brothers and my sisters all over this land. Well, if I had a song, I'd sing it in the morning, I'd sing it in the evening, all over this land. I'd sing out a warning, I'd sing out danger, I'd sing out love between my brothers and my sisters all over this land. hammer, and I've got a bell, and I've got a song to sing all over this land. It's the hammer of justice, it's the bell of freedom, it's the song about the love between my brothers and my sisters all over this land. One more time. It's the hammer of justice, it's the bell of freedom, it's the song about the love between my brothers and my sisters all over.
I just learned it yesterday, so hopefully it goes well.
Well, this country ain't nothing but a company's dream. A couple hundred million workers, that's all that they see. Our hands on the tools, money writing the rules. From the sweatshop prisons to the cops in the schools, you got the middle class living like they're gonna last. Working hard, longer hard hours for less and less cash. Got the media spins, Republican twins. Got the war profiteer for the executive friends. You got the heroin running through the veins of the poor. Got the ghettos locked down, paying blood for the war. Got the cities decay, the dealers to pay, and the death squads working for the CIA. Got a million new jobs inside a thousand new jails. Outsourcing the unions, profit tipping the scales. Got a brand up, got a drugged up truth, a trumped up youth. You got snipers out with rifles on the factory news. You got 30 minute speech for losing eyes. You got arms, a cop, some tough out there breaking the laws. You got the front row seat to your own defeat. You got the tear gas canisters filling the streets. Laws all written for the rich and the white. Took the rest of those fools into the army to fight. In a dead-end game, each war's the same. You got a land full of people and a market to claim. You got a woman beaten down everywhere that you look. In the schools and the jails and the courts and the books. Got the TV set, sexism's on it. Got a culture full of men taught to fall for that shit. Yeah, and I do too. I'm not blaming you, but I'm trying to unlearn what they said was true. Yeah, and I need help, I'm not afraid to say it. It's a subliminal tool, sometimes it's hard to see it. Yeah, you got the job in the office, you got your own room. You got the pen and the paper and the drive to consume. Got the suit pressed in, got to admit that you win. And the race to replace true ambition. You got move up the ladder at the company speed. You gotta learn to dance quick for the company's greed. You gotta justify every step that you can with your eyes closed tight and your head in the sand. You gotta fight the desire to fight the police. You gotta fight your heart and your every belief. And you're gone, 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 yeah, there's no coming back until you realize your potential. Raise your fist and react. Yeah! Look to each other and to ourselves and ignore the phony remedies they stock on the shelves. We can undermine the greed on which the system depends and hope to build a new world made for lovers and friends. Gotta work from the bottom what we want at the top. We gotta work together if we want this to stop. From the thick grassroots to the top of the tree, I want peace, justice, and anarchy. I want peace, justice, and anarchy.